Programs rarely do their tasks alone. They either have to store or send representations of data to be consumed by other programs in a format that is well understood. This serialization process comes with a lot of questions, like how to make sure the deserialized data structure uses the same types as the original one, how not to break programs when you need to change the format, and among others, how to make the process fast. In this video, we will talk about two of the commonly used formats, JSON and Protobuf, and see how both of them address the same issues in different ways. To start, let's take a simple piece of data. A user visits our website, and we would like to store when and which URL they have visited, like in a very simple analytics platform. We can build, for example, a Java class and pass instances of that class throughout our program. When we want to get outside of these boundaries, we'll need to somehow serialize the instance. One way to do that is to create a JSON object that has a timestamp and the URL in it. We can write the serialization code ourselves or use an off-the-shelf library for now. Similarly, if we have an application reading from that JSON in, let's say, Ruby, we can easily parse the JSON to an internal data structure using the built-in JSON library or one of the faster alternatives. In this case, since we're not using any special data types, it's not really a problem. There are a couple of things that are great about exchanging JSON between applications. First, it's readable. JSON is just text, and we can, at any point, open any object with the text viewer and examine it. Secondly, it's self-contained. Everything a consumer needs is embedded within the object, so you can start sending JSON and accepting it without any synchronization. This brings me to the fact that JSON is extensible. We can easily extend the data that we're storing in the JSON object without significant harm to the clients. However, JSON isn't perfect. At high volumes, the cost of serializing and deserializing objects is non-negligible. It becomes a significant overhead. Adding to that, with JSON, we don't have clearly defined types. That's actually a feature, but for some applications, this is not desirable. For example, according to the specification, JSON is agnostic about numbers, so if you want to store an unsigned 32-bit integer, there is absolutely no way to specify that. Which means that when you parse a JSON, you have to allocate an arbitrary amount of memory, which can become a problem. And finally, JSON is massive. The most compact representation of our message is 51 bytes. The URL is 19 bytes, and the timestamp can be expressed as a 32, or if you're optimistic about humanity not dying in 20 years, 64-bit integer, which gives us 4 bytes for the timestamp. So we have a total of 23 bytes of content in a 51-byte message. That's a lot of overhead. Protobuf tries to address these points by taking another approach. Instead of passing the schema with every message, we can save space and power by declaring the schema beforehand. So we can create a protofile that says, a message will contain a timestamp and a URL, and we can use this file to both encode and decode object. Since both the encoder and decoder will have the protofile, we don't have to actually pass the field names themselves. In Protobuf, we assign codes to the fields, and they will be used to mark where one field ends and another one starts. Then while we're at it, we can also use this schema to store the types of the data we store. This looks good, but with JSON you had ubiquity. Because it's so simple to parse and generate, you can connect pieces written in different programming languages. After all, it's just a string. Protobuf is binary, so it doesn't really have this advantage of being easily portable on your own. So the creators decided to port it themselves by shipping generators for most popular programming languages. Here's how it works in our example. To our Java project, we add the protofile that contains the definition of the message and run a task, which will generate a Java class that we can use to build our project. On the Ruby side, we can also use the generator from the same protofile to generate Ruby code. This code can be used to write and read the protobuf objects, so we don't have to write any of the serialization code ourselves. And that's it. We have two apps in different programming languages that can efficiently exchange messages. In short, JSON is great when you have small volumes of messages exchanged, when you want to inspect the data, and when your messages are more different among each other. Protobuf is great when you exchange high volumes of the same type of message, and when performance really matters. So as a rule of thumb, I use JSON if it's something I'm sending to a browser, and I would use Protobuf if I want to exchange messages between services. Actually, Protobuf can take this serialization idea one step further with gRPC, a way to call other services by sending them messages. But that's a subject for another video. Thanks for watching.